I am a big pleasure for me. So with your daughter?
Yes.
Facciamo la cuffia per lei.
Ciao Andrea, come va? I think we can start. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Eliana LaFerrara. I'm a professor of economics at Bocconi University, and I'm here in my capacity of a member of the advisory board of the Andrea Bocelli Foundation. It's a pleasure to be here, and I would like to welcome all of you to this event. I came in contact with Andrea's foundation through a good friend of Andrea's, Muhammad Abdul Latif Jamil, who's the founder of the Poverty Action Lab at MIT, and through colleagues like Abhijit Banerjee, who's sitting to my left, or Esther Duflo, who are world-caliber researchers who've been working at the Poverty Action Lab. We've been trying to collaborate recently with the Bocelli Foundation to try and shape up their research and action agenda on fighting poverty. So this workshop, it's the Break the Barriers workshop, is aimed to try and support, promote projects which have the goal of helping disadvantaged people in Italy and in developing countries who live in conditions of poverty, illness, malnutrition, and social exclusion. So the foundation aims at promoting interventions in favor of health, education, and social integration, and wants to do so by measuring as far as possible the effects of its interventions with the objective of constant improvement. So I'd like to thank the international speakers who take part in this workshop, the authorities, and the university rectors. Their presence is a strong and reassuring signal for the foundation that this is a start in the right direction. The official language of this workshop is going to be English, but I'd like to switch briefly to Italian to describe the aim of this second event that the foundation is holding in Italy for a broad audience, and also because I want to welcome the Italian authorities and among all, to introduce Andrea Bocelli, who's the creator and the soul of the foundation. So I'll say a few words in Italian now. Buonasera a tutti, benvenuti a questa seconda giornata di lavoro organizzata all'interno del programma Break the Barriers della Fondazione Bocelli. Io sono Eliana LaFerrara, sono docente di economia all'Università Bocconi e sono qui anche come membro del board, dell'advisory board della fondazione. Il programma Break the Barriers ha l'obiettivo di sostenere e promuovere progetti che aiutino le fasce più deboli della popolazione in Italia e nei paesi in via di sviluppo. Quindi i beneficiari saranno persone che vivono in condizioni di povertà, malattia, malnutrizione ed esclusione sociale. La Fondazione intende promuovere interventi a favore della salute, dell'istruzione e dell'integrazione sociale e intende farlo con un metodo preciso, cioè andando a misurare, ove possibile, l'impatto del proprio intervento. Questo perché in questo modo sarà possibile migliorarlo continuamente. Il workshop di oggi ha come titolo Combattere la povertà, un dovere di tutti, e vuole essere un'occasione per riflettere insieme a questi eccezionali ospiti e ai membri dell'advisory su quello che potrebbe essere il modo più efficace di agire in base alle risorse umane ed economiche che abbiamo. Quindi il programma, come vedrete, prevede una riflessione iniziale che cercherò di fare brevemente sul ruolo della ricerca nell'analizzare i bisogni e nel valutare l'impatto delle politiche sociali e dei progetti di cooperazione. Successivamente il professor Abhijit Banerjee porterà a questo proposito una testimonianza del Jamil Poverty Action Lab dell'MIT di Boston. Seguirà poi una testimonianza di come il pensiero e l'operato di una persona, il professor Yunus, possano influenzare la vita di milioni di persone. E infine ci sarà un esempio molto toccante di come gruppi di artisti professionisti che lavorano in tutto il mondo si stiano attivando per lavorare gratuitamente a sostegno delle economie più povere. Quindi tutte queste componenti molto diverse tra loro, la ricerca, il pensiero, l'azione, l'arte, muovono cause e fondi diversi e possono, se messe in dialogo, avere un impatto sulla povertà. Questa è un po' la scommessa di oggi. Quindi l'obiettivo sarà di cercare di far di questi mondi diversi per verificare se e come possano coesistere e generare circoli virtuosi utili al miglioramento della vita di tutti. Quindi vorrei ora lasciare la parola al maestro Bocelli, che è l'ideatore e l'anima pulsante della fondazione. And I hope you will all enjoy and get the best out of this day. Thank you and grazie. Andrea.
Buongiorno a tutti, come al solito mi prendete impreparato, perché io credevo oggi di essere qui per ascoltare, per imparare finalmente qualcosa. Perché se qualcuno mi chiedesse perché sono qui, perché ho fatto la fondazione, perché ho pensato a creare una fondazione, io in tutta onestà dovrei dire non lo so. Sicuramente non per capacità, non perché le mie conoscenze di tutto ciò che ruota attorno alle fondazioni è poca cosa. Diciamo, si tratta di qualche reminiscenza di studi antichi. Solo che osservando il mondo attorno a me mi sono reso conto che se uno fa una scelta di campo e decide di stare dalla parte del bene, cioè di fare qualcosa anche per gli altri, si trova immediatamente nella difficoltà di capire come farlo, perché poi per fare il bene bisogna essere capaci di farlo. Il bene sta al male come il costruire sta al distruggere, no? Per tutte e due le cose ci vuole una certa capacità, ma sicuramente per costruire ce ne vuole di più. Quindi chi decida di fare del bene deve sapere di avere di fronte a sé una delle più grandi e complesse sfide. Quindi l'unico modo per farlo è quello di cercare di comporre una squadra di persone capaci, nella quale ciascuno stia nel proprio ruolo e faccia al meglio quello che sa fare. E perché mi sono trovato a fare io tutto questo? È un po' strano anche per me. Ma vedete, diceva una volta una vecchia commedia, se il mondo vuol così. Evidentemente il fatto di avere una faccia conosciuta, una faccia, insomma, un volto noto, ti mette nelle condizioni di muovere tante energie e tante forze che senza questa notorietà, anche se tutto questo è essenzialmente ridicolo, non si potrebbe fare. Mi viene in mente un libro letto tanti anni fa, è un libro di Fyodor Dostoevsky, che si intitola I demoni, no? Nel quale appunto si spiega questa strana cosa che c'è nel mondo, per cui ci sono delle persone nate per metterci la faccia, no? Nate per comunicare un messaggio. Piotr Vierkvievsky si attacca a Nikolai Vsevolodovich proprio per dirgli: guarda, aiutami a fare questo, faccio tutto io, ma te devi esserci, perché se non ci sei te non riuscirò a fare nulla di quello che ho intenzione di fare. In questa vicenda io faccio un po' la parte di Nikolai Vsevolodovich, speriamo di non farla fino in fondo, perché nel libro Nikolai poi muore impiccato, io non vorrei fare questa fine, ovviamente, vorrei fare un'altra. Però è un po' vero questo, no? Se il buon Dio mi ha messo nelle condizioni di essere intonato e mi ha dato una voce che evidentemente suggerisce delle sane emozioni a qualcuno, io ho il dovere di coinvolgere in sogni, in progetti, tante altre persone mille volte più capaci di me. Allora abbiamo composto una squadra e io sono il primo a essere veramente sbalordito di avere qui a fianco a me oggi il signor Yunus, che in fatto di lotta contro la povertà è veramente un grande maestro. Io ringrazio tutti voi della vostra attenzione, della partecipazione, soprattutto dell'aiuto che ciascuno di voi vorrà darci. E ringrazio anche sentitamente il signor Yunus di essere qui e di aver realizzato quello che veramente è un sogno per la Fondazione Andrea Bocelli. Grazie.
Grazie Andrea per queste parole. Vorrei adesso chiamare al saluto alcune autorità che ci fanno il piacere di essere qua oggi pomeriggio, iniziando dal sindaco di Pisa, il dottor Marco Filippeschi.
Grazie, grazie. Do il mio saluto e benvenuto al professor Yunus e agli altri gentili ospiti. Siamo grati di avervi con noi oggi e naturalmente sono molto grato alla Fondazione Andrea Bocelli e a Andrea Bocelli di persona, perché ci ha dato due splendide occasioni di confronto e di riflessione, di confronto fra esperienze diverse, con un raggio molto ampio, un raggio planetario, come si deve fare. Prima, qualche giorno fa, sull'innovazione tecnologica, sull'uso della rivoluzione digitale, in particolare a servizio della vita dell'uomo, a superare problemi di salute, di condizione che si possono superare oggi, e oggi contro la povertà. Questi incontri fanno crescere anche il prestigio della nostra città, sono una ricchezza, un dono assai gradito, e voglio dire che se sarà necessario la città saprà dare sponda al lavoro della Fondazione. È un lavoro che, come dicevo, ha un raggio globale, ma Pisa è una città che ha una grande visibilità, che ha una grande tradizione di studi, di cultura, che ha anche un grande futuro e si mette a disposizione con le sue diverse istituzioni. La lotta alla povertà, alle povertà, per lo sviluppo, per creare anche nuove imprese e nuovi imprenditori in contesti difficilissimi è stata l'esperienza riconosciuta del professor Yunus, di cui credo dobbiamo essere grati, perché ha dato il segno di come si possa costruire, oltre che teorizzare, mettere in pratica idee nuove, creare dal basso nuove economie. Lottare contro la povertà significa portare avanti in modo coerente una critica al modello di globalizzazione fondato sul dominio della finanza, che ha lasciato in campo purtroppo tante macerie e una crisi ancora oggi molto difficile da risolvere, che tocca tanti paesi, che ormai tocca anche i paesi che avevano mostrato negli ultimi anni le performance di crescita migliori. Però la critica deve sempre proporre alternative positive, di aiuto e di riequilibrio a favore dei paesi più poveri, di sviluppo sostenibile e di democrazia, di dialogo tra diversi e tra esperienze diverse. Credo che questo sia lo spirito con il quale la Fondazione Andrea Bocelli avvia questo lavoro così importante, ispirato ad una logica pressante del dono, della capacità di mettere a valore esperienze, visibilità e anche capacità di intervento concreto a favore di chi ne ha bisogno, con una ispirazione culturale e con legami di altissimo livello che fanno già onore all'impostazione del lavoro della Fondazione. Grazie di tutto questo.
Grazie Sindaco. Cedo adesso la parola al Rettore della Scuola Superiore Sant'Anna di Pisa, la professoressa Carrozza.
Buonasera, mi è stato detto che oggi le autorità hanno 2 minuti a testa, quindi cercherò di stare nei tempi dei 2 minuti. Sono qui a testimoniare ancora una volta che la Scuola Superiore Sant'Anna è vicino alla Fondazione Andrea Bocelli, partecipando personalmente anche con numerosi allievi che vedo in sala, presenti, che sono attivi nel settore della cooperazione internazionale, hanno interesse anche a contribuire volontariamente nei loro periodi di vacanza, nei loro periodi estivi, con appositi stage in paesi dove c'è bisogno della loro competenza e delle loro conoscenze. Dico 2 parole sulla scuola e sul fatto che non solo è molto grata alla Fondazione per aver organizzato questi 2 workshop, sono 2 temi, 2 assi portanti delle attività di ricerca e formazione della Scuola Sant'Anna, ed è per questo che ho aderito così entusiasticamente, anche personalmente, a queste iniziative, quindi l'assistenza personale, lo sviluppo di tecnologie per il supporto e la sostituzione funzionale per soggetti che hanno avuto disabilità motorie o cognitive, e oggi la lotta contro la povertà. Noi abbiamo lanciato dei progetti trasversali come Scuola Superiore Sant'Anna in questo momento di problema di spending review e di conseguenze anche delle scelte che dobbiamo fare per rientrare dopo questo periodo di crisi e come dire, riportare sul giusto binario la nostra economia. Siamo in un momento di riflessione anche di orientamento delle nostre attività e abbiamo pensato proprio in questo momento di crisi di rilanciare un progetto trasversale a tutti i nostri istituti di ricerca che riguarda la mobilità sociale e quindi la possibilità di riportare l'università, in particolare la Scuola Superiore Sant'Anna, con i suoi obiettivi di collegio di merito, verso quella promozione sociale di giovani che nascono in condizioni territoriali o socio-economiche particolarmente disagiate, andarli a prendere e cercare là dove crescono e si sviluppano, accompagnarli nel loro periodo di studi per poi aiutarli a entrare alla Scuola Superiore Sant'Anna o in altre scuole a statuto speciale. Questo è un progetto di mobilità sociale che vede uniti scienze politiche, ingegneria e giurisprudenza in una economia, in un'attività proprio come un progetto che poi andrà a individuare quali sono gli strumenti per riportare. Ricordiamoci che l'università aveva questo obiettivo che gradualmente si è andato perdendo a causa dei costi dell'istruzione. Noi vorremmo riportare, cercare almeno di sviluppare delle politiche in questo senso. Quindi con questo spirito diciamo che la lotta alla povertà la consideriamo una delle nostre missioni, seppur non quella primaria che è quella dell'educazione, però la combinazione di questa missione della lotta alla povertà e al disagio sociale e l'educazione ci dovrebbe portare ad aiutare giovani meritevoli e a portarli agli studi e possibilmente al loro sviluppo professionale. Quindi oggi ascolterò con interesse questo seminario, spero che anche gli allievi, gli studenti presenti ne traggano beneficio come esempio di come si può impegnare il proprio talento al servizio degli altri. Questo è il messaggio più importante della Fondazione Bocelli, del workshop di oggi e degli illustri colleghi che stanno per parlare. Grazie.
Grazie professoressa Carrozza. Abbiamo adesso il saluto del rettore dell'Università di Pisa, il professor Augello.
Buonasera a tutti, benvenuto professor Yunus, benvenuto maestro Bocelli. Io prenderò i 2 minuti anche del venerdì scorso, se mi consentite, non mi è stato possibile partecipare a quella iniziativa perché avevamo un incontro con il nostro ministro a Firenze. Questo è un momento difficile per il sistema universitario e tante energie vanno dedicate appunto alla sensibilizzazione delle problematiche della ricerca e della formazione. È un onore per me, in rappresentanza dell'Università di Pisa, partecipare a questo workshop. testimoniando il sostegno, la vicinanza, il contributo dell'Ateneo a queste prime iniziative italiane della Fondazione Andrea Bocelli. È stato ricordato che venerdì scorso sono stati portati alcuni esempi di come la tecnologia può essere impiegata al servizio dell'uomo, e questo pomeriggio non è meno importante perché il dibattito si concentrerà su idee e progetti per combattere la povertà nel mondo, in particolare nei paesi sottosviluppati. Momento centrale sarà la testimonianza del premio Nobel per la pace Mohamed Yunus, al quale rivolgo un saluto caloroso, il quale, come sappiamo, è riuscito a realizzare in Bangladesh un sistema di microcredito per finanziare quei piccolissimi imprenditori che rimanevano esclusi dai circuiti bancari tradizionali. Da economista e da storico dell'economia, devo dire che un sistema che ha dimostrato di avere una sua forte, rigorosa logica economica e dunque di poter funzionare come dimostrano i dati. Una considerazione relativa anche al metodo, relativa al segnale che viene dalle iniziative, da queste prime iniziative della Fondazione. Mirano ad unire momento di riflessione e capacità di formulare proposte concrete attraverso la collaborazione scientifica tra i ricercatori internazionali. È stato il caso del progetto Sfide, sarà oggi il caso di questo progetto Break the Barriers. Io sono particolarmente grato a Maestro Bocelli di aver organizzato questi appuntamenti e ancora di più di aver scelto Pisa, di aver scelto la nostra città come sede di questa iniziativa, a dimostrazione di un legame che egli ha con la sua università e con il suo territorio. Maestro Bocelli è un nostro laureato in giurisprudenza, senza dubbio il laureato più conosciuto al mondo, il laureato dell'Università di Pisa più conosciuto al mondo. Lo ricordava poc'anzi lui, avere un viso noto per meriti che tutti gli riconosciamo aiuta. E noi di riflesso siamo contenti di ciò. Non è un legame casuale, quindi quello con Pisa, con la sua università. Ha sostenuto come presidente onorario le attività della Fondazione ARPA, che come è noto è nato per iniziativa del professor Franco Mosca per promuovere la ricerca e la formazione nei vari campi della sanità, e devo dire che grazie alle tante attività messe in campo numerosi medici della scuola pisana hanno potuto sviluppare percorsi di qualificazione e aggiornamento professionale all'estero, specializzandosi in vari settori, ma soprattutto realizzando progetti formativi e assistenziali. Queste sono le finalità principali che sono nello spirito della Fondazione ARPA nei paesi in via di sviluppo. Desidero approfittare infine di questa occasione per annunciare ufficialmente che a settembre l'Associazione dei Laureati dell'Ateneo Pisano, l'ALAP, abbiamo qui il Presidente Ghezzi, conferirà ad Andrea Bocelli il Campano d'Oro, che è un importante riconoscimento che in passato è stato assegnato all'ex presidente Ciampi, al premio Nobel Rubbia, da ultimo lo scorso anno all'attuale presidente dell'Accademia dei Lincei, Lamberto Maffei. E mi piace ricordare un piccolissimo passo delle motivazioni in cui si ricorda che Andrea Bocelli non è solo la voce italiana più conosciuta e apprezzata al mondo, ma anche e soprattutto un uomo dotato di uno spessore culturale non comune e di una sensibilità particolare che arriva, proprio come la sua voce, direttamente al cuore delle persone. Ringrazio dunque ancora il maestro Bocelli, le valorose persone che collaborano con lui a questa nuova e appassionante sfida della Fondazione, alla quale io auguro veramente tutti i successi che meritano, e vorrei concludere lunga vita ad Andrea Nicolai. Grazie.
Grazie.
Grazie professor Augello. Abbiamo adesso un ultimo saluto che sarà in video ed è il saluto di padre Rick da Haiti.
Io lo dico sempre che la tecnologia ha bisogno di andare avanti.
Andrea and dear Veronica, allow me to congratulate you and to offer my prayers of thanksgiving and blessing for the two births that you're celebrating. First, the birth of Virginia, fruit of your love, and I've seen her pictures when she was born, and again of her baptism, and she's such a beautiful child. And also the birth of your new foundation, Fondazione Andrea Bocelli, which is also fruit of love for humanity, especially for those who are in suffering. I want to especially thank you for choosing to support Fondazione Francesca Rava with your new foundation, and through Fondazione Rava, of strengthening us in the work that we're doing together for so many babies, children, young people, and old people as well in Haiti, in order to bring them out of difficulty and suffering and to lead them into a life of dignity and independence and blessing. I thank God with you and with many other people for the beauty, the miracle of your voice. And I ask God to help you use your voice as you have so often in the past, that your voice might be that of an ambassador for people who are in difficulty, and that through your singing and your music, you may raise up many, many people into a life of hope. Thank you, congratulations again, and God's blessing. Dear Andrea and dear Veronica.
Please read.
So, thanks, Father Rick, although you can't hear us. We can now start the main part of this workshop, which, as I mentioned before, will be a journey from the approach of research to anti-poverty policies to a successful example of partnership between research and action, that of the Poverty Action Lab, to another equally successful example of action, that of Professor Yunus. So I'll be the first one to speak on the value of research for anti-poverty policy, and then I'll come back here and the other speakers will take my place. Very good. Okay, so what I want to try and do is give you a bit of a flavor that hopefully will not be too technical on what we do when we create partnerships between academic institutions and people engaged in policy and in action, okay? And why is this not a stupid question to ask? Because, you know, there's a lot of resources flowing towards poor people, developing countries, foreign aid, and there's no consensus on whether this is a good or a bad thing. Okay, so there's a view which we could call the skeptics' view, and Professor Bill Easterly from NYU is often associated with this view, according to which we don't really have hard evidence that aid leads to development or growth. Okay? Actually, these people argue that aid might even impede development or growth because it generates rent-seeking, corruption, waste of resources. Okay? And there's an opposite view. We could call this the optimist view of foreign aid, and Jeff Sachs is one of the best-known names that support this view. And according to this view, we actually know what to do with aid. We just need more and more resources to scale up projects that we think are successful. And the Millennium Villages is one recent example of how this view has tried to have an impact. Okay? And when you try and reconcile these two views, they're so different and so, you know, extreme that it might not be easy to believe who's right or who's wrong. So what I'd like to do is to tell you how we go about this, okay, when we don't want to be ideological and believe that something is necessarily good or necessarily bad, how we go about it, that is, try to use rigorous methods to come up with an answer. And I'll briefly talk about the tools, so the type of research that is done in this respect. I'll give you an example of interesting findings that you can eventually come up with and that wouldn't be obvious before you start this analysis, and also how this can be used by people like foundations, NGOs, international organizations who don't have an interest in the research per se, but want this research to be relevant for action. Okay? And I'll showcase findings and examples from a broad area where development has really tried to make a difference, that is education policy. So providing poor people with the basic form of capital that they need, that is human capital, so building themselves, learning to read, to count, and to, you know, eventually have the skills that may be required in the labor market. So if we think about resources that have gone into education, a lot of poor countries have made important sacrifices and spent a lot on primary education or even secondary education. And we tend to take it for granted that you spend on education, the country is going to do better. The people are going to do better. Now, there was an early study by a World Bank economist, Lance Pritchett, who tried to, you know, really gather data to look whether this was true, and he put education on one side and GDP per worker on the other. So this, if it were true that education is so good, we should find a positive relationship. So that would be countries with a lot of educated people should grow very fast, okay? And this cloud of points that you see on the screen are basically the relationship that Pritchett found in the data. So GDP is on the horizontal axis, so when you move from left to right, you are going from poor to rich countries. And then human capital is on the vertical axis after accounting for some other determinants of growth. And you see there's not these clear positive directions in which the points are moving. They are a little bit scattered all over the place. That means that it would not be enough for a country to invest in education and try to move right to necessarily generate growth and fight poverty. Okay? So now this really runs against common wisdom. If you were asked, do you think it's a good idea for a foundation to invest in building schools or paying more teachers, you would say, of course it is. This is one of the most basic needs and one of the avenues where we are most sure to make a difference. And I think that scatterplot would be too quickly interpreted as evidence that this is wrong. Okay? That scatterplot doesn't tell you that this is true, nor that it is wrong. Okay? It could be that we didn't find a relationship, not because education is not good, but because we invested in the wrong program. So we don't know how the money was used. Okay? It could also be that maybe the investment was in the right program, but money got lost along the way, or people didn't show up where teachers didn't show up when they were supposed to go to class. So in order to really know whether it's worth putting money in a program, we need to evaluate all aspects of that intervention, and eventually, if we evaluate it rigorously, we'll be able to say whether it's effective. So the way in which research can have a practical impact, according to this view, which is not either pessimist or optimist ex ante, a priori, it becomes exposed, the way in which research helps is to say, okay, let me see how I would evaluate one of these projects, okay? And I'm going to give you, as an example, the decision to build an extra school, or you could think decision to build an extra hospital if you're thinking about health. Now, one temptation would be to say, okay, if I build a school in this village, I could go there before the school is built. So I go there, I measure how much people can read, and then I go there 3-5 years later. The school is now up and running, and I see whether now more people can actually read than before. If I see an improvement or a difference, I say, this is the impact of my program, and I'm happy that I'm making a difference. Okay? Now, actually, this is not really kosher. Why? Because in these 3 to 5 years, lots of things could have happened. We're not sure whether it's the school that's benefiting those children. Maybe they suddenly got TV. They're watching a lot of TV, they get stimulated, they start being curious and read more. So how do we know it's actually the school? And then you could say, okay, now forget about the before after. Let me take another village, a nearby village, where we didn't build a school. Okay? And then I'm going to compare kids in the village where I've put the project with kids in a village where I didn't. And if I see that my kids are doing better, then this time I can take credit for this difference. And again, you know, I would say, well, why didn't you build a school in the other village? Was it just by chance, or there was some reason why you picked your village? And you could say, well, you know, my village was really the poorest. These kids needed the school the most. Oh, but then maybe your kids in the village that you have selected were so behind that if I go and measure this comparison now, maybe they haven't even caught up with the first group. But this doesn't mean that the school wasn't effective. It means that you selected a village that was not really comparable to the other one. So when we need to make these comparisons, there's a keyword that we use, and that is really a little bit of the ghost for the evaluator. And this keyword is counterfactual. So counterfactual means that we need to figure out in some way what would have happened in that village if you had not built the school. So we need to have something that by construction you don't observe in the data, because now you have built it, the school. You don't know what would have happened today without the school, but you need to use methods that allow you to get as close as possible to that hypothetical situation, okay? And that means basically recreating a group that is as close as possible and as similar as possible to the village or the people you selected for these interventions. So we talk about treatment and control groups that would be those who receive the school or the program and those who don't. And the difficulty lies in coming up with the composition of these groups that really allows you to say, this is what I've done, and it's not the result of something else that was happening at the same time. Now, one way in which this can be done, and Professor Banerjee will talk at length about this, is through random assignment. So this means that basically when you have to place a school or a hospital or do anything else, you select a potential population and you randomly pick some of the beneficiaries. There is actually a lot of merit to this approach, and Professor Banerjee will go more in depth in explaining why. Okay? Another type of methodology really works more with programs that, for example, government have implemented without this random component and use thresholds, eligibility. So these are all kind of technical tricks that we try and use, but I think more than going into how we actually do it, I want to give you examples of why this approach of not being content with the most obvious answer, yes, before, after worked well, or you know, village with or village without worked well, going for the rigorous evaluation way really can give you an edge. How it can avoid making mistakes when you have so few resources and you want to make sure that you allocate them where they yield the most benefit. And the first example I want to briefly describe is a really important and famous program launched by the Mexican government in 1998. This program is called PROGRESA. PROGRESA is a cash transfer program. So this is one of the, you know, very common ways in which poor people get help from the governments, and that is, if you qualify because your income is below a certain threshold, then we give you a cash transfer. It's a subsidy. Now, the problem with this is that, you know, many people would say, well, does everyone deserve this transfer? Or what happens if you get the transfer? Maybe then you don't look for a job or whatever. So there's all sorts of discussion, but what the Mexican government said is, look, I'm giving these transfers because I want to somehow relieve these very poor households from the need to send their kids to work. Okay? So what we want is that the household will have just enough so that their kids can attend school, and that will be enough for us. So how did they do it? They put a clause, which we call conditionality, that says, you know, you are entitled to these transfers, but the teachers will take attendance. And if your kid doesn't show up in class at least 85% of the time, you lose the money. Okay? This way, the mothers and fathers of these children really have incentives to send these children to school because they get money out of it. And similar conditionality were put with health checkups. So they also had to go and regularly visit clinics. And why this program was so innovative is not only the conditionality element, but also that the government wasn't really so sure it was going to work, and it wasn't so sure of how much money they should give to poor people to persuade them to send kids to school. So what they did was to engage a group of prominent academics from the best US departments and say, how would we evaluate whether we are doing right or not? And these academics designed a randomized evaluation. So out of all the villages that were going to get these transfers, they basically, because they couldn't just reach everyone at the same time, they decided two-thirds were going to get it immediately, and one-third was going to get it 3 years later. Okay? And they didn't want to do injustice to anyone, so they said, we'll hold a public lottery. So who goes first is not our decision, there's no political motive, it will just be chance. Now, what this allowed the government to do was to say, look, now if I compare the two types of villages, there is no particular reason why I gave the transfer first to the first group. It was a lottery. It's not that they were poorer or that they were, you know, more politically connected. So now, if I do compare whether kids go to school more, I can really safely take credit for that. Okay? And they indeed found that the transfer was helping households send children more to school. So they were successful. But they learned something that they didn't know before. Okay? And this was that giving money to every household and every child was not really the efficient thing that they should do. Why? Because the improvement in attendance when kids were in elementary school was kind of low. So, you know, these enrollment levels went up, but they went up by 3 percentage points. That's not a major result when you're putting billions of dollars in a program like that. On the other hand, if you looked at secondary schools, and if you looked at girls, their enrollment went up a lot more, 15 percentage points. So this exercise, which looks just like a dry playing with data to come up with numbers, 3 versus 15, had a very important impact because it allowed the government to say, now we can take some of that money, give less to families that have young children, because this family would send the kid to school anyway. So if I really want to make a difference in terms of enrolling more in middle and secondary school, I can increase the subsidy a bit more for the other families. So I can adjust my policy, I can adjust my program after I learn from this intervention. And this was so important and so widely appreciated that the program was scaled up and it survived, you know, a change in government. But the reason it was really appreciated was the effects, and especially the fact that nobody could contest those effects. Nobody could say, well, I don't believe you, there could be something else going on. So this rigorous evaluation method bought a lot of credibility and a lot of support to this program. Okay? Other researchers have done similar things looking at smaller scale interventions. So a professor from Harvard University, Michael Kremer, together with other collaborators, did a series of important projects in Africa, partnering with this NGO called ICS Africa and helping them to understand how performance of children in primary schools in Kenya could be improved. So we're talking about villages where very few children are literate, where people are extremely poor. And the reason this NGO got interested in this research collaboration was that they really didn't know how to spend their money. So they wanted to do something for education, but they weren't sure whether they would need to buy textbooks for the kids, or just to give them free meals so that the kids would be encouraged to go to school, or give free uniforms, because no children can go to school without a uniform, and that's costly for the household. Or maybe they should just treat the children against some illnesses so that they feel better and they go more to school, or when they are in school, instead of being just dizzy, they can learn better. Okay? So all of these things, if you think about them individually, you wouldn't say, I'm doing something bad if I finance this project. It's clearly something good. But we don't have tons of money. So among many good things, we need to be able to pick the ones that have the highest returns. That's how economists think. We think in terms of returns, like on investment, okay? And so what he did, pretty much with the same methodology, this randomized evaluation, he found that textbooks, contrarily to what we would assume, weren't as effective. Why? Well, maybe if they're in English and kids don't speak English, they don't really read the textbook, or maybe they wouldn't take them home. So free meals were good. They managed to increase attendance. They increased it by 30%. Uniforms increased attendance as well. But these small pills, for example, that cost almost nothing, managed to increase attendance and performance an awful lot. So with all these results taken together, basically he was able to give recommendations to the NGO on where they should put the money. And I think I'll skip on this last intervention, which was done in the Dominican Republic, and just conclude with how this partnership with rigorous evaluation methods and with researchers who help do this type of work can be useful for someone who's interested in policy. The first way, as I said, is that we can't take for granted that something is going to have a positive effect. Okay? We found plenty of examples where things that seemed obvious didn't have the positive impact expected. So first of all, you learn. You have to start from the precondition that you don't know what's going to work and you need to learn. Second is that even if you find out that it is good and that it improves the outcome that you're interested in, you need to know by how much. Okay? So you need to come up with a number that is as precise as you can get. And that's because when you allocate your money, that number is going to guide your criterion for putting it in one place or in the other. And these estimates can only be reliable if they're done with the right methodology. So this graph, which I borrowed from the J-PAL website, so it's also a good transition to the talk that's coming next, is what we call a cost-benefit calculation. So this graph is created in the following way. You know how much you spend for a given program. You know how much it costs to buy a uniform for a child. And through this evaluation, you also know how many extra months of school that uniform is going to generate. Okay, so the impact, you measure it through the evaluation. The cost, you have it from your accounts. And you do it for the uniforms, you do it from the deworming, for the deworming pills, you do it for the cash transfer like the Progressa one. And once you compare how much you spent and how much extra education you got in exchange, you see cases where, like the Progressa, every extra year of education costed you something like $6,000, okay? Maybe we say, oh, $6,000 is not so much for an extra year of education. But if you compare it to, say, the school uniform, you could get an extra year of education only with $99 per child. And if you compare it to a deworming pill, you could get an extra year of education with $3.50, okay? So these magnitudes are really striking. And this type of comparison is something that you wouldn't be able to do unless all of these possible interventions had been done with a common methodology for evaluation, okay? So I think that, you know, there's a lot of potential for using solutions that we know, so we don't necessarily need to find a new technology for fighting poverty. There are several candidates, but these technologies need to be assessed. And I think that research is good at helping assess whether a technology works and which technology works best. So I think that's where, as academics or as evaluators, we can complement the work and the action that foundations, NGOs, and international organizations do. And I think that giving the floor to Abhijit Banerjee is the best way to prove this. Thank you. So, sorry, this is very funny that I keep changing mic, but I need to say a couple of words about Abhijit before he starts talking. So that's when I wear my hat of chair of this session. So if you were someone like, you know, the students that are following us from the other rooms, the name of Abhijit Banerjee would be pretty much what the name of Andrea Bocelli is to musicians around the world. So he's really a leading figure and you know, one of the people who has had most impact on development economics in recent years. He's a graduate from Harvard, and he's teaching at the MIT. So this is the institution that, through J-PAL, also is partnering with the Bocelli Foundation. And what Abhijit did at MIT was to build a career based on very important theoretical and empirical contribution. So this is what academics do, but he wasn't happy just to have become a star in the international academia. Abhijit, together with Esther Duflo and Sandel Moulay-Nathan, decided that they wanted to put their talent to the service of poor people. I think this is a lot of what we're talking about. Okay, you have a talent and you want to try and help other people who need it. And the way Abhijit did it was to try and, you know, he took a bet. He did something that nobody had tried before, okay? He took a bet of saying, look, I'm going to run these anti-poverty projects, not the way they've been run so far, but with the best methods that I can do in order to come up, that I can use in order to come up with those answers. Now, what this means is that he has basically created a revolution for all the development economists around the world that challenged them to revise the way they were using data and they were assessing projects. And the impact has gone as far as to affecting the action of the World Bank, most important NGOs and foundations around the world. So I think this is great because it's an example of someone who could have just been happy with the, you know, academic career and fame that he had, but he decided to take a risk, and the risk has been a real revolution to development economics. So with this, I want to give the floor to Abhijit Banerjee.
Thank you, Eliana, for that excessively generous introduction, and thank you for the Fondazione Andrea Bocelli for organizing this event, and congratulations to the foundations on being born. It's kind of nice to be born at this size. It's most of us don't manage this. You already have an audience. You already have a set of people who are interested in what you're doing. You already have started doing things, and that's all before you were born. So it's pretty impressive, and congratulations. I'm sure this will continue. What I want to do, as Eliana advertised, is talk about our organization, which is the Abdul Latif Jamil Poverty Action Lab. And I want to talk about what we do in JPAL. And Eliana already spoke extensively about the kind of work we do, so I have less to say, but I'll try and give you a sense of why maybe what we are doing is a little bit different, and where we think we got some leverage. So what JPAL was founded in 2003. JPAL is the acronym for the Poverty Action Lab. And it's grown from a network of 12 affiliated professors with 40 projects to now we have, I think, 70 professors, distinguished professors like Eliana on all the distinguished universities in the world, with, you know, in Europe and in the US and everywhere else. And we work in over 50 countries. We have offices in 5 continents. And I think we have, to some at least limited extent, a seat at the table, at any table where development issues get discussed. And this is something that I certainly had no expectation that this is how we will get to in 9 years. And I wanted to, so thinking back, I was more trying to figure out what did we do right. The first thing we did right was we got lucky. We got very lucky in the early supporters like Mr. Jamil. We got very lucky in our early partners like Pratham, which is one of the is the biggest NGO working on education in the world. So we ended up with a bunch of very, very fortuitous and fortunate relationships, which of course make life a lot easier. We also, I think, did some things that are, I think, right in specific ways. And what I want to do, I'll say what they are and then come back to you some examples of our work to suggest, to give you a sense of what do I mean when I say those things. Hopefully they're not just empty words. So first, I think we decided to focus on practical issues. And practical issues for academics is something of, you know, so it's great for an academic to say, sit in his office and say, education is great. It's easy, you can say it, sounds good. I think what we decided to do is, instead of talking about whether education is great or not, we decided we're going to figure out how to do education at the ground level. It's a very different question. It's not a question of saying education is good. It's figuring out, you know, how exactly to change this particular classroom to make it work a little bit better. So, you know, what exactly? So things like, you know, how do you get children to take pills that will make them less sick? So in school, or how do you get when teachers don't themselves know how to use computers, but you want to introduce computers in school, how do you train those teachers so that they don't break the computer? So this is sort of very nitty-gritty level, this detailed intervention. So one of the key things we did was we actually got very much into the question of how exactly to do something, rather than the abstraction of education or healthcare or, you know, other wonderful things that are out there. But we really got into the on the ground and got our hands dirty. And the second thing we did, I think, right, was we we didn't assume that we knew everything. I think that was, for an academic, that's a difficult thing to do. But we somehow managed. So we and you'll see, we started on many things. I think the reason why we got somewhere is because we were willing to ask the question, why not this other thing? Rather than saying, oh, I know the answer, let's just do that. And most of the time when you do that, you say that you discover that the reason why you didn't, you know, why not? Why not? Because it's stupid. You do a lot of work and you discover that you had a stupid idea and that's the end of it. But sometimes you discover something very surprising and really encouraging. So it's the advantage of being open-minded is that, you know, that you hit the brick wall quite, the disadvantage, you hit the brick wall quite often. The advantage is that you sometimes find that the wall wasn't a wall at all and you're in an open field with beautiful flowers. And that particular, that's one side of it. The other side of it, however, is we also learned that you should not take the world's view of things too seriously. And I'll give you an example of that as well. You know, people come and tell you that, you know, we are practical people, you're academics, you don't know anything. And that's also a danger because, you know, it's too easy to say that, yes, there's wisdom in the world, we should just embrace it. So what we did was we had a constructive, I think, and a democratic engagement with that knowledge. And I think that's been very profitable for us. We have neither accepted that, you know, there are experts out there and we don't know anything, nor have we started with the presumption that we know everything and that no one else does. And I think that sounds obvious, but it is something of a different way of operating. Finally, I think we've been very careful to avoid ideology. That, you know, that in some sense, some answers, I think people often start with the idea that some answers are just not admissible answers. And we had the advantage that we stayed away from saying that some answers are right because they have to be right. That's how it is. But on the other hand, we also did not fall into the trap of saying, look, you know, anything can happen. So we were always careful to take one lesson and ask, if this is true, then why is it true? And we kept pushing that. So let me give you some examples. And this is all talk. It sounds good, but it's just talk. Let me give you some examples. So here's one thing. So how do you get children to immunize? Immunization for children under 2 is one of the absolute obvious lifesavers we have. Very, very cheap and very, very effective. Saves lives in the next generation. So the women who get pregnant and then get rubella have blind children, for example. So that's it's a very, 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 very long-term investment. But the problem is that a lot of people don't get immunized, and this is in some ways what's sad about it is that it's not immunizations are cheap. In the end, UNICEF makes it very, very cheap. So most countries do poor countries, immunization is basically free to the governments. The governments have systems for delivering them. Most places, that's the last mile. In case you were wondering what that is, so the government have systems for delivering it, but if the area we were working, which is this beautiful part of India, the immunization rates when we started working were 1%. 1% of children were fully immunized. Fully immunized, they had got 5 shots, then they had all 5 shots, 1% were. Why was, and so when it was a classic example of, you know, sort of experts stepping in. So when we found that, we went to them and everybody said, that's obvious. So everybody had a different reason why it was obvious. It was not that it was obvious to everybody, but it wasn't obvious for the same reason. It was obvious for different reasons to different people. So one set of people thought, well, you know, these government hospitals, they are just crowded. They don't work, so you can't get anything. So that's an example of a government hospital. The door is closed. So when you go to the government hospital, the person is not there. The person is maybe gone home, or is asking for bribes to get immunized. So that's why you can't get immunized. That was one very common view. The one set of experts, or basically the entire NGO community, with the exception of the one NGO we were working with, took this view. The opposite view came from the government, and this should have printed, but it didn't for some reasons I don't understand. There should be a whole set of, and this is the view that people don't want to be immunized. And this is a New York Times story about that, but like, you know, there's a lot of people who say that, you know, their traditional beliefs, these people have extreme, you know, they don't believe in this modern medicine, they believe in traditional medicine, why would they want to get immunized? So these were the two views, and, you know, and at that point, one thing you could do is stop, say, okay, we know that, you know, the two views, both of them say it's not possible, so we can just walk away. Now, what we tried to do instead of walking away is actually, because I think this NGO in this area we had worked with for a long time, they were willing to trust us to say, look, let's, instead of just walking away from this problem, let's actually try out some ideas. Let's be a bit more aggressive. Let's ask questions. So the way we asked questions was the following. So there were two interventions, which were, again, as Eliana described, we chose a bunch of villages, about 180 villages, and we randomly selected 60 in each group. And these villages, what we were choosing in these villages was, in each set of villages, there would be a different intervention. So one set of villages, we did nothing, that's the core kind of this, and we chose them randomly because then they would be comparable. If you choose them by lottery, then there's no difference between them. Anybody can win the lottery, so all these villages were the same to start with. Then what we did was we said, okay, so then we basically kind of by lottery chose villages. The white villages is where nothing happened. The existing system continued. In the red village, the green, blue villages, the NGO organized a camp every month. So yeah, remember, everybody, some people were saying, look, you can't get immunized. So this NGO basically guaranteed that every month there'll be one day, they'll announce that day from the beginning. So every month it was in a particular village, it's the first Wednesday of the month, there will be somebody will come and immunize. And so it was, and this would happen every month, so it was quite easy to get your children immunized. And we checked, and the camps happened 95% of the time when it was predicted, and if not, they went and told them that it's not going to happen this week, but it'll happen next week instead. So they did a pretty, very good job of that. That was one part of it. The second thing we did, and this was which was really controversial, we said, look, you know, maybe these people just forget. Let's make it a bit more memorable, these incidents. Mm-hmm. So what we did was we said, if you get your child immunized, you're going to get 1 kilo of lentils, you know, dried beans. 1 kilo of that, and this is not, even in this part of the world, this is not a lot of money. It's not something that people get, it's not going to make you rich. It's just a token. It's something to make you a little bit more excited about this. You know, otherwise, taking your child to get immunized is a pain. I mean, you know, a child cries, you know, you have to take the child or in the sun to go there, so you don't do it. Maybe it's... So this is what happened. So these were this shows that the randomization worked. Basically, when you randomly choose villages, before we did anything, the immunization rates were exactly the same everywhere, zero. And you see that zero, it's really zero. It's like difference between zero and one is not, I mean, just sort of statistical differences, but no, there's no real differences between these places. Then, with two years later, we went back to collect the data, and we find that, well, you know, in the places where nothing had been done, things had improved a little. It was 5% now instead of 1%. If you went to the places where the camps were run, things did improve. They improved from, you know, 5% against 5% was 17%. So that's a lot better. And here's what's really surprising. When you actually offer people the dried beans, they suddenly it jumps to 37%. So in other 38%. So in other words, a very small token gift changes people's behavior. Now, this essentially says two things. It says that it cannot be that these people were not, they really wanted to get immunized and they just couldn't get immunized because the government was not providing it, because even if you provide it, they don't really always do it. On the other hand, it says it cannot also be because that they have this strong traditional belief, and that's why they don't do it. Because if they're traditional belief, they're not going to sacrifice those strong traditional beliefs for a kilo of dried beans. So it was just that they were not doing it because they were not doing it. And if you don't ask the question, is that possible? Is it possible? And you just accept the theories that are available, then you never do anything. So you have to sort of engage with the world, try to see why things work the way they do, and not leave it as saying that, you know, there are theories and theories explain everything. So that's, I think, the first example. Now, here's what was striking about this example. Remember, we were in the places where we had incentives, which is this beans, we were giving away money. When you give away money, you think that it costs more to immunize children. But in fact, it costs less. Why? Because so many more people came that per child immunized, the cost was lower when you gave away money than when you didn't. So, you know, this seems completely paradoxical that, you know, if I give away money, it's going to cost less. But it costs less per child because in the end, somebody has to go there and wait. Mm-hmm. And that person's time has to be paid in any case. So if now nobody comes, you don't get much benefit. So you actually reduce costs by paying money. Let me give you another example. Eliana, how much more time should
so
I take?
I think you have 10 more minutes.
Perfect. Here's an example of where, again, this is so fertilizer adoption in Kenya. Fertilizer is again, another very easy win. Very easy to use fertilizer to get bigger gains in agriculture. Agriculture is now, you know, food is now increasingly becoming the shortage in food is re-emerging in the world. So why don't people use fertilizer? Only like 15-17% of the people in Western Kenya use fertilizer. It has high returns. And people have endlessly talked about, you know, what are possibilities. Maybe the returns aren't high. Maybe people don't know. Maybe people don't have enough money. So first thing, we wanted to know what's going on. And one way you could do is you could do, there's all these theories. Now what do we do about it? Another thing you can do is you can actually start getting into the field. And as I said, get your hands dirty. You start getting in there. The first thing we did was we gave some farmers, we meaning not me, but some other JPL researchers, gave some farmers some free fertilizer and encouraged them to use it. When they used it, they got huge returns, 150% returns on the fertilizer. For every one euro for spent on fertilizer, they got 2.50 euros back. So there was really great returns. So then next year we thought, okay, now that they've seen it's wonderful, they'll all use it. And no, next year they went back to not using it. So why weren't they using it? So we scratched our head and said, well, maybe it's, so the returns are not low, there's no information. And, you know, we kind of spent a lot of time discussing this. And then somebody had the good idea of asking the farmers. And they said, we have no money. But that made no sense. I mean, why could fertilizer doesn't cost anything? I mean, it's relative to what they earn. It doesn't cost anything. So it can't possibly be that. And we puzzled about that for a while. And then we understood what they were saying. They were saying, we had money. We don't have it anymore. Because essentially, you get money at the end of your harvest season, when you get the crop. Then you eat that out of that money for a long time. 6 months later, you have to plant. By that time, the money has run out. So they don't have money when... So we basically, once you understood that, when you actually heard what people were saying, you actually internalized what the message was, then it was very clear what you had to do. You had to offer them the opportunity to buy fertilizer at the time when the harvest came in. Not later, but when they had money. When you offer it to them, you get, suddenly... you get a big increase in fertilizer use, and it's as large as the impact of a 50% cut in prices. So you can reduce the price, but you don't actually do anything. You didn't have to reduce the price. You could cut the price by 50%, you'll get the same increase. But it was much cheaper way to do it was to just actually figure out what they needed. They needed delivery at that time. They didn't want a discount. They wanted nothing. You just had to give it to them when they had the money. And if you heard them right, you would get that. Let me give you the last example. The last example is one from on a different domain, which is fighting prejudice. So people in India often vote based on caste. Caste has a hereditary, you know, some families are from one caste, some from the other caste. And basically what happens as a result of this, what happens is that people, the dominant caste in a particular area will win. Why? Because, you know, everybody votes because of their own caste. Then, you know, when you vote for your, you know, the biggest caste wins the election. And that means that if I'm from the biggest caste, I can afford to be corrupt. I don't really need to be do anything. I can just steal the money, and still everybody will support me in any case because of my name. I'm going to win. So what, again, this was something where, you know, this was always assumed that this is something that is inevitable. Till we change social structures, nothing can change. So what we did, you know, how do you affect this? So this is, the problem is that this is, this was a classic case where we had to figure out the means of delivery. How do you get people to affect this at all? So we worked with an NGO, and we ended up spending lots of time designing puppet shows. I don't know what you know puppet shows are. Puppets like, you know, marionette, you know. We were pulling puppets, so we were designing puppet shows where the puppet shows were going to represent the idea that people should not vote mechanically based on their caste. They should think about development issues. So that idea was being passed through a set of puppet shows. Here's a poster. We spent some time designing posters. You know, it was very, very crude. Very crude. You know, we are not very sophisticated at these things. We had songs. There was a nice song that was written for this purpose. But this, all of this, we had to be involved in. So it was it's a different way of doing research, because we had to be involved in what's the right kind of song. And, you know, we heard a bunch of songs and decided this is the right song. So this was a very different way of doing research. And when you do that, and we randomly chose villages where this campaign was done, and you see that this campaign was run for exactly 2 hours a day for every village. Every village got covered for just 2 hours. So, you know, these villages are not small. They have 400, 500 households. So, you know, 2 hours, you don't really cover that much. Even though very little of the village was covered, when you look at what happened, the probability that you vote for your own caste candidate went down by 7 percentage points, which is enough to make a difference between winning and losing. So these were, we could have just assumed that this is something that's a, you know, historically given structure and you cannot change it. Or you can figure out how to affect it. And by being aggressive about trying to understand how to do things on the ground, we could then affect the voting patterns quite easily. And it turns out that, in fact, people were perfectly willing to change their mind. So I think, to summarize, I think our strength is that we work in the real world with real world partners. That we bring in, as I said, a democratic partnership the thing that has made us, I think, more maybe successful than other academics, or at least maybe more, at least more, I think we are more engaged with the facts, at least, is precisely this willingness to sort of get down to the level at which the partners operate. So rather than sort of talk down to them about, you know, this is the right theory and that's the wrong theory, and that, you know, you need to know this is expert has said that this is true. It's not that we don't come with expertise. We know something about how to evaluate. We also know a bunch of, you know, what we learned, you know, what was done in Afghanistan is useful in some other country. So we know, we have a body of evidence that we can call on. But we also don't assume that we know the answer. We come with some knowledge, but we participate in conversations, and those conversations are what make us, we get our kicks from those conversations. That's what we really enjoy, and in the end, I think that that's what also makes us useful. So we're very much looking forward to working with ABF. Congratulations again, and thank you.
Thank you, Abhijit, for this excellent and very convincing description of the work you do. So I'd like now to introduce the next speaker, who actually could be done in 2 seconds, because this is someone who doesn't need any introduction, and that's Professor Muhammad Yunus. You all know that he is a recipient of one of the most prestigious prizes that you can get, that's the Nobel Prize. And I think what I like about this is that Professor Yunus is also an economist. He was professor at Chittagong University in Bangladesh. And so the starting point is somewhat similar. All the discussions you're hearing today come from people who've spent a lot of time thinking, a lot of time on books. And yet, what way did he choose? He basically also chose to put a lot of his own, starting from his own money when he first gave out the first loans, and the effect of this small action became a movement, it became a bank, it became a new theory about how to fight poverty that has really also changed the world. And you think about economists, you think about recognition, and you think, okay, you know, maybe one day if I find out something really clever, I'll get the Nobel Prize for economics. And I think very few economists could aspire to the Peace Nobel Prize. And if you try to fight poverty, that's pretty much the best you can get. So I'm really honored and happy to introduce to you Professor Yunus, the banker of the poor.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, I was having a goosebump sitting next to Maestro Bocelli. It's a legend in his lifetime, and it's a wonderful occasion to meet him face to face. Not only meeting, actually sitting next to him for all this time in this workshop. And I'm very lucky, very fortunate to do that. And he has invited me to join his advisory committee for his foundation. I was very privileged to have that opportunity to serve in the advisory board of his foundation. I'll try to do my best to make sure whatever there's wishes and desires that he has to this foundation to overcome all the problems that we see around us in a more significant way, we'll try to do that. And also it's very special for me to sitting next to my daughter in the same panel. So this is another opportunity for me to speak dad and daughter together. And also this is a very exciting moment for me that she'll be singing tomorrow with Maestro Bocelli. So that's also a great, great opportunity for me to be here and listen to both of them singing. What we have been doing back home in Bangladesh was something to begin with, very insignificant actually, but the circumstances pushed us in that direction. This is in mid-70s when I was teaching economics in the university located in Chittagong. And a terrible economic situation persisting in the country, a situation of famine raging in the country, people dying of hunger. So you come with the great confidence in your subject that this is capable of overcoming lots of the human problem in the economic field. But you go there and see people die of hunger and you have very little to contribute with your knowledge to overcome that. And while you're teaching those elegant theories of economics in the classroom, you feel totally empty in the face of the problem that you see. That's what pushed me in a direction that I never turned back again. The direction was, why don't I just go ahead and be with the people who are suffering through these miseries of hunger? Without feeling that knowledge that you have acquired, quote unquote, acquired in your classroom, even you feel that that has no use for this situation. But as a human being, you can be useful to other human beings. That's what makes you feel that a little bit more confident. So what I try to do, make myself useful to another human being, even if it is only for a day or so. It's nothing to be ashamed of, nothing to be running away from. So this is precisely what I wanted to do, going into the village and be with the people, see is there some use for me, for them. And I did a lot of little things to make that happen, and some make me feel happy, some made me feel unhappy that I didn't do the way I should have done. But along the way, I also discovered the people, discovered the village, discovered the way they live. And one such thing was loan sharking in the village. That led me to the question, how to make people get away from this loan sharking. One idea came to my mind, why should they go to the loan sharks? Why can't I lend the money to them myself? That way, going to the loan shark will not be necessary. So this is the first step I did. I lend money myself, trying to keep them away from the loan sharks. An excitement that it created in the village kind of pushed me to do more. The question that came to my mind, if you can make so many people so happy with such a small amount of money, why shouldn't you do more of it? So I wanted to do more of it. And the amount involved is so small that it didn't really feel terrible that I'm using my money to lend them the money. Then I thought, why don't I connect the people to the bank? Because bank is just located in the campus. And this is the village next door to the campus, and that's the village where Monica was born. And it's a part of my life. And I said, why don't I help them connect it with the village, with the bank next to the village? Bank manager said, it's impossible to lend money. Bank cannot lend money to the poor people because they are not creditworthy. So that's irritated me. The more I argued that it should be done, and that's the most logical thing to do, but they rejected it outright. And I started making accusation against them, saying that banking is a very funny institution because it is supposed to lend money to people, but they do a very funny way. They lend money to people who already have money. They don't lend money to people who don't have the money. I said, this is such an illogical thing to do. They should be lending money to the people who don't have the money rather than give the money to the people who already have money. But they didn't listen to my argument. They thought I was funny. They are the right one. So I continued to do that. Ultimately, after months of such attempt to convince them to open their door, I finally, in order to make it happen, I offered myself as a guarantor. I said, I'll become the guarantor. I'll sign all your papers, and you give the money. If the borrowers didn't pay back, I'll pay you back. So responsibility is on me. So ultimately, they bought that idea. They accepted it reluctantly, not very enthusiastically, because I'm making their life miserable by arguing against them. So accepted me to sign the document as a guarantor and lend the money. So this was the beginning of the bank relationship with us. We took the money, lent the money to the people, and came up with ideas how to make it easy for people to pay back. And those ideas worked. And now, as it grew, bank became very reluctant because they thought it will remain very small so that their risk will be limited to a very small amount of money. Now that it's growing, I'm lending money to more and more people, guaranteeing myself, but still they didn't believe that I could pay that money back if something happened. So the more reluctant they became, I became interested in creating a new bank so that I can do it myself. So that took me some time, and finally we created a bank, called it Grameen Bank or Village Bank, and started working through that. And gradually that bank became a nationwide bank. And today that bank has 8.5 million borrowers. 97% of them are women. And we lend out over $1.5 billion every year in tiny loans with a very high repayment record. And we continue to do so. We work in every single village in Bangladesh. And that idea has spread outside the country. in many, many countries around the world became known as microcredit or microfinance. And I'm sure there are some microfinance people right here in the audience who practice microfinance in Italy. So that idea has a power to be transplanted in any situation because that the gap in the banking system is so wide that everybody needs the service to come and fill up that gap. People ask me, how did you design this whole banking system in such an intricate way? I tried to explain, but I thought it makes more sense to say it in a different way. It makes a good impact on mine. I said, well, it was very simple for me to design all these things. Because every time I face a new situation, I look at the conventional banks. How do they handle that situation? Because they have been in business for a long time. So once I learn how they do it, I just do the opposite. And it worked. And everything I did is almost the opposite of what the conventional banks do. Conventional banks go to the rich people. Richer you are, more attractive you are. We reverse that principle. We go to the poor. The poorer you are, more attractive you are. If you have nothing, you are the most desirable person for the bank. And we get very excited to find you that you have nothing. We have no system of collateral because conventional banks want collateral. Anything you want to borrow, any amount you want to borrow, you have to show if you have enough wealth to match up with that. We threw away that whole idea of collateral. We said, since we are dealing with the poor people, the question of collateral doesn't arise. So we wanted to make sure that we do the banking on the basis of the trust rather than on the basis of any material objects like wealth and other things. Since we don't have any system of collateral, so we don't have any legal papers of this transaction between the bank and the borrower. Since we don't have the legal document for transaction, we don't have any lawyers in our bank. So this is the only bank in the world which is lawyer-free. You don't need any lawyer to do that, so because it's a trust-based banking and so on. And not only it works in Bangladesh, it works everywhere else in the same way. Another principle we took, again, conventional banks require you to come to their office to do business. We changed that. We said people should not come to the bank. Banks should go to the people. So we reversed that. So we do the business at the doorstep of the borrowers. And that's what makes it easy for us to go to the poor people and poor women. Conventional banks are more focused to men. We reversed it. We made it focused to women and poor women. So 97% of our borrowers are women. And conventional banks are owned by rich people, usually rich men. So that's also reversed in Grameen Bank. Grameen Bank is owned by poor people. It's owned by poor women. So entire bank is owned by the borrowers themselves. So it's not somebody, something owned by some other rich people or something. So the bank makes profit. Profit goes back to the poor people as a dividend for their bank, the shares that they have in the bank. So case by case, piece by piece, you see everything is done in a reverse way. It's not just a conventional bank giving a tiny loan, calling it microcredit. That's not how microcredit was born. Microcredit was born with an entirely different system, which addresses the people in a very different way. And the whole philosophy behind it is very different way. So we continued to do that and also insisted that borrowers not only take loan from the bank, also create a habit of saving so that each borrower has savings account. And most of them, almost all of them, have multiple savings account under different savings plans. When you are saving tiny little money regularly each week, over a period of time, that money grows, that money becomes big. As I said, we lend out over $1.5 billion. None of this money comes from outside. This is all internally generated money. So Grameen Bank is not going out to take money, borrow money, take grant from governments or international institutions or anybody else. All the money is generated within the system by taking deposits. It is the depositors' money that we lend out to the poor people. And that's where all the money comes. The important thing is not only we take the depositors' money and lend the money to the poor people. Out of the $1.5 billion that we lend out, nearly $1 billion is the deposit of the borrower themselves. So it's the same borrower who has, as a depositor, deposits the money, saves the money in the bank, at the same time borrow the money from the bank. In many branches of Grameen Bank, more than, there are 2,600 branches of Grameen Bank, more than 500 branches of Grameen Bank where the amount borrowed by borrowers is smaller than the loan, smaller than the deposit they have in the bank. So in true sense, they are the net lender to the bank rather than the net borrower of the bank. So relationship has changed. And in other branches, the amount that they borrow is almost very close to the amount they saved in the bank. So that's a relationship people don't realize how powerful it is. Even the poorest person, if you put your savings into work, it grows into huge, big amount of money. Many argue that, well, only the entrepreneurial poor can handle this kind of money, otherwise this will not be useful to the poor people. I have been arguing since then when this idea came that only entrepreneurial poor can handle. I said all human beings are entrepreneurs without any exceptions. Simply, some people found it out, some accidentally, some by some exposure, some training, some education, they discovered it. And many, many, many remain undiscovered to themselves. That power of entrepreneurship inside of them never been discovered. So how to make it happen that people discover their own entrepreneurship? And Grameen Bank or microcredit organizations are examples of that, how to create that entrepreneurship. When we try to lend money to women, they are not jumping at the money, give me the money, I'll do the business. No, they were running away from the money. The more eager we were to give them the loan, the more frightened they were about the money, handling money. They said, I never handled money in my life. I don't want to touch that money. So it's our task to see that we can persuade, we can build confidence in them. When in the beginning, it's very difficult to convince women to take loan from Grameen Bank, because we are insisting that half the borrowers in Grameen Bank must be women, because our entire banking system is totally oriented to men. So I wanted to amend that. I want to change it in my system, making at least half the borrowers as women. But the women are very reluctant to take the money. So my students who are working with me, to going house to house talking to women, accused me of insisting of something which is never going to happen, the getting women to accept loan from Grameen Bank. And I said, look, don't be impatient. You have to be very patient. When a woman says, I don't have the capacity to use money, I'm afraid of taking money, I don't know how to work with money, never believe that this is her voice that you are listening. You are only listening to the voice of the history. History what made her, which made her believe that she is nobody. She's not capable of doing anything. So our job is to be patient and peel off that fear which created her layer by layer, so that someday the real person will come out and say, maybe I should try. Why don't I try? And then once somebody tries it and is successful, it will have a snowball effect. It will encourage her neighbors to do the same thing. And then it will start growing. So we have to wait for that moment when it happened. It took us 6 years finally to make it happen and come to the level gradually to 50-50. Then we saw money going to the family through women brought so much more benefit to the family than the money going to the family through men. So watching it again and again, we started questioning the very principle of 50-50. We said, why 50-50? Why don't we focus on women? And then we started focusing on women. And that's the result which came up. Today, 97% of the borrowers are women. When the Grameen idea, microcredit idea, spreads in other countries, they don't go through the same experience that we have gone through. They go straight to women. In most of the countries, most of the places, this is 100% women. They don't even try to give money to men, because it's well proven, well decided to that. We started a microcredit program in New York City in 2008. Now we have 4 branches in New York City. 5th branch is about to start. We have over 9,000 borrowers in New York City, 100% women. Average loan is $1,500. And repayment rate is over 99%, 99.3%. So exactly the same thing what we do in the village of Bangladesh. We repeat the same thing in New York City. It works the same way. It was so attractive to other cities that we were invited by Omaha, Nebraska, about 2.5 years back to start a branch in Omaha, Nebraska. So 2.5 years back, we started that branch. Now we are about to set up a second branch in Omaha, Nebraska, because it's very successful in Omaha. Last year, we started a program in Indianapolis, and that's also working very well, similar to New York City. This year, we just started in San Francisco, one branch, about 3 months back. Next one is coming up in Detroit, and next one in North Carolina. So it's because they see the same situation, same reason. See, we have been told in economics that competition will finally resolve all the problems of the market imperfections and so on. It's good in theories, but in practice it doesn't work. Only way a poor, low-income person can borrow money in New York City or anywhere in the United States is to go to the payday lenders. And payday lenders, they flourish all over the United States. Interest rate, 50%, 100%, 500%, 2,000%, it flourishes. Conventional banks don't go anywhere near them. This is a market they want to stay away from. So just because you can take 500% interest rate doesn't attract conventional banks to go and make money out of that. So those ideas that finally all this competition will come and make it happen. Competition never eliminated the loan sharking anywhere in the world. They flourish everywhere. So you have to go and intervene and do your own thing, make it happen in a completely different way, outside of what you call the financial or the economic system, competitions, that market competition that will do. We were told that not only you need entrepreneurial poor, you need a very special kind of persons, at least a little bit well off among the poor to do that. Since I didn't believe in it, what I did, I started lending money to the beggars to prove that even the beggars could be as entrepreneurial as anybody else. What we did to the beggars, about 5 years back it started, what we did, we go to the beggars and start explaining what we do and they explaining what they do. And then we give the idea that why don't you take some money and start selling things door to door. And as you go from door to door begging, it will be easy for you to sell something. You can do both. And we make it sound very easy by saying that, well, you are going there anyway. This is not extra work for you. So all you have to do, give people option, whether they would like to buy something from you or they give something free, some food, some money, as a charity to you for your food and for your survival. They started liking that idea. We started lending the money to them so that they can buy the things to sell. In the beginning, our idea was maybe there'll be 1,000, 2,000 beggars who will do that and we'll see how they can manage it, whether they will be total failure in this or they'll be total successful. It became very popular. Very soon, we had more than 100,000 beggars taking money and doing the door-to-door sales work. And within 2 years' time, we see many more coming, and more they are repaying the loan, taking more loans to get a bigger enterprise building up. Today, more than 22,000 beggars have stopped begging completely because they became successful door-to-door salesperson. So if you can transform a beggar into a salesperson, by his or her own choice, not because you forced anybody, by just lending a few dollars. His usual amount of loan they take in the beginning is something like $12 to $15. By $15 loan, if you can bring up that entrepreneurial ability in them and make it happen, this is not a big deal, and they are paying you back. no collateral, nothing, and make it happen. Not only it happens when you talk to them, tell you, they will tell you their experience. They can tell you which house is good for begging and which house is good for selling. So I tell my colleagues, I said, they have not gone to MIT Business School or Harvard Business School, but they understand the market segmentation very well. They do it, they have already learned from their own jobs what they're doing. So. And some of my colleagues get very worried why they are taking so much time to stop begging and completely relying on selling things. I try to cool them down. I said, look, begging is their core business, and selling is their new division they have made. So it takes time to close down your core business and completely focus on your new division that you just created. It takes a lot of confidence building in themselves to do that. So they have to match their risk-taking capacity how to do that. So I mentioned that the entrepreneurial capability is not limited to few people. It's only a question of opportunities that we do. One question we face repeatedly, what is the cause, why poverty is caused? What is the cause of poverty? And I always come back by saying that poverty is not created by the poor people. It's not generated by the person. Poverty is imposed from outside. So people are not the one who is responsible for their poverty. It is the system which has imposed the poverty on them. They have this, poor people have the same creative power as anybody else. As a human being, they are as capable, as creative, as full of potential as any human being anywhere else. Simply, system didn't allow them to use their capacity, even to know the existence of that capacity. That's what makes poverty. One of the things we did in Grameen Bank early on to encourage their children to go to school, because the parents are totally literate. Literacy never entered on those families. So what we did through our own work, encourage the families to send their children to school. It became a responsibility of Grameen staff to make sure 100% of the children of the borrowers that he or she is responsible for are in school. And as a result, we became successful in having almost 100% of the children in school. And we wanted to encourage them by giving them scholarships, giving them encouragement, celebrations, and so on and so forth. And they started moving from primary school to the junior high school and senior high school and so on. Then started coming to the college. And college is more expensive than high school. And they started dropping off because they cannot afford it. And we said, no, you don't have to drop off. We give you education loan. So we started giving education loan, anybody who would qualify to go to college. So we have now nearly 50,000 students right now who are in medical schools, engineering schools, universities. So we have many PhDs in Grameen families where the parents are totally literate, but the children are highly qualified people. You see the mother and the daughter side by side. One is totally literate, and the daughter is a medical doctor. And you wonder what happened in between the two generations. The mother, the question that comes to your mind right away, the mother could have been a doctor too, but the society never gave her a chance. She never even got the opportunity to go to school to learn her alphabets or write and read and so on. But her daughter got an opportunity coming from an institution which encouraged her to stay in school and gave her a student loan to make sure she finishes her school, and she became a doctor. So what is poverty after all? Is it something that her mother didn't do and became poor? Or is it because her daughter do and became a doctor? Or something is missing in the system as a whole, because we are waiting for somebody to do something else and it never happens, so we follow the same route as it is. If it is in the system, we have to change the system. That's as simple as that. If we can correct the system, there is nobody in the world who will be a poor person, because it doesn't belong to him or to belong to her. It belongs to the system. What is the system? System is about the institutions that we build. Look at the banking institutions. Why, after all these years of what we have done in microcredit and so on, still banks don't open their door to lend money to the poor people? And still microcredit is a kind of a footnote to the banking system. It's not a mainstream banking. Microcredit doesn't even have a law for it. And I was just mentioned I'm the banker to the poor. You said, if I'm the banker to the poor, who are the other people who do the banking? Aren't they banker to the rich? By definition, if I'm banker to the poor, they are banker to the rich. Why should there be banker to the rich only? Why couldn't it be the banker to the people? All kinds of people. So that's where we went wrong, that we created a very kind of lopsided institutions which created poverty. Because you denied, in the beginning you said they are not creditworthy. Today you can't say that. The rich people who are not paying back. When the financial crisis came, it is the rich who didn't pay back. Still the poor were paying back right there in New York City where the big banks were collapsing in 2008. Microcredit, Grameen America was flourishing in the same city. They were not missing a single installment of their repayment. So can you now come back and say, who, ask the same question, who are creditworthy? I think if you ask that question, who are creditworthy, it will be overwhelmingly, the verdict will be, is the poor who are the creditworthy. You have questions about the rich. But it's still the banking system remains as it is. And along the way, what we did, and let me finish this education loan a little bit more. After they were doing graduation from the high universities and so on, one question kept repeated to me and asking me the question and again, what is the use of doing this graduation, doing this degrees and so on? There's no job in Bangladesh. And finding a job is such a difficult task. You have to bribe the people who are hiring you, their officials. Or you have to have very powerful people making phone calls so that you can get a job. And the poor people have no money to bribe the officials. They don't have big people to make telephone calls for their jobs. It's a very frustrating experience. So in the beginning, I was not sure how to resolve that. Then I came around and started taking groups of those young people and started telling them, look, you are a very privileged young people, unlike young people for other families, because you are children of Grameen families. You are privileged because your mother owns a bank. So why should you be worried about jobs? Your mother's bank have unlimited money. As much money as you can borrow, they have it. There's no shortage of money for that bank. So why can't you start thinking in a different way? And you make a pledge for yourself. As you wake up in the morning, you repeat that pledge. And the pledge is, I'm not a job seeker. I'm a job giver. My mission in life is to create jobs and go for it. And if you feel frustrated, how am I going to create jobs? I don't have a job myself. Always think about your mother, what she did. She's an illiterate woman. She was scared to death to borrow her first $30 or $40. She was trembling. She couldn't stand still to hold this money. But she had the courage. She mastered her courage to take the responsibility of that $30 and to make use of it so that she can earn enough to pay back the loan and still have some left for her. And that was the beginning. She has remained with the bank for 20 years. In the process, you are born. She sent you to school, and today you are a graduate, you are a doctor, you are an engineer. What good is your education if you are not better than your illiterate mother? If she can create her own enterprise, absolutely illiterate person, how come you are scared to death in doing the same thing? If you have no idea how to where to start, you have in-house consultant, your mother, sitting there with long experience. Why didn't you learn from her? So how to build the company she built, which over 15 years, make it 50 times bigger with your money, with your expertise, and so on and so forth. So now we are lending money to the next generation so that they can start their businesses quite a different size, quite a different kind than her mother did or his mother did. And that's what we are encouraging, the entrepreneurship young people, rather than become job seeker. That's what our education system does. And that's where our education system is wrong. Because we are encouraging our children, work hard, go to the best school possible, get the best degree, and get the best job. I said, that's not an exciting prospect for a young person, to slave for somebody for the rest of their life. Why can't we be yourself and do things as you want to be, in the way that you would like to express yourself, rather than fit into a slot in some company, in some office, someplace, and stay there for the rest of your life. Anyway, that's what the educational system issue was. Is. Along the way, what we did, every time I see a problem, I immediately created a company to solve that problem, created a business to solve the problem. It started right when Grameen Bank began. In a tiny little way, I started creating businesses to solve problems. One of the first business I created was a seed business, because people were suffering from night blindness. Every family I meet, the children cannot see at night. I couldn't understand why children cannot see at night. What's the problem with these kids? I was totally puzzled. So I started talking to the doctors and experts. They told me, well, this is just a night blindness. It's called night blindness. All you have to do is to give them vitamin A. Once they have vitamin A, their eyesight will be okay. Where do I get the vitamin A? Oh, you give the vitamin A tablets, or encourage them to eat vegetables. So I skipped the vitamin A tablet option. I went for vegetable option. So started encouraging every family to grow vegetables so that they can feed their families with vegetables, which they didn't have the habit of. Bangladesh has a lot of fertile soil, but somehow people are stuck with the rice. They don't even think about the enough of vegetable easily can be grown. So we thought we should encourage them to grow vegetables. So we started selling seeds in small packets, 1 penny packets, so that they can get the packet, they buy the packet, and sell, and they start producing that vegetable around the household. And it became so popular. In the process, as the Grameen Bank grew, we became the largest seed seller in the country. In the process, night blindness disappeared from the country. So this was kind of first business effort we did. And then many other efforts, sanitary latrine, we started selling sanitary latrine, housing loan to build houses and so on, separate companies and so on. And then we did solar energy, because Bangladesh doesn't have much of energy. So we created a company called Grameen Shakti or Grameen Energy to bring solar energy in the country. People were shocked, what is this solar energy? How do you create electricity? Because they are used to kerosene lamps, little lamps that they do. After sunset, whole Bangladesh is as dark as the primitive age. All you have is tiny little kerosene lamps everywhere. You see very little out of that. So we said we can change that by bringing solar energy. But everybody said, oh, this is too expensive, nobody will buy that. It was expensive, it was difficult to sell. 16 years back, we created that company. Selling one solar home system in a month was a big challenge, but we never gave up. We did that, and then we tried to sell 5 solar home systems per month. We did that, increased to 10 solar home systems per month. We did that, and today we sell more than 1,000 solar home systems per day. And we are just about reaching the first 1,000,000 solar home system working in Bangladesh, all paid for, no subsidy involved, and people have their own solar energy, and they're proud of it. And that, as oil prices go up, solar panel cost comes down, the gap between the two becomes smaller and smaller. It becomes more and more attractive to have the solar energy. So now solar energy is a common practice in Bangladesh. We have nearly about 25, 26 million families. So we will be doing the first 1,000,000 families, and hopefully we will be doing in the next 10 to 15 years so that we can have every single household with a solar home system. Before the fossil fuel comes, we can do this as fast as we can, and it will serve. And it is a business. But again, all these businesses I have created more than 50 such businesses. But all these businesses are focused on solving one or the other problem. I had no intention of making any money from any company. I don't own any single share of any of these companies. And people ask me, why do you create these companies? I said, to solve problems. Business has a tremendous power. in solving problems in a very efficient way. But unfortunately, we created a structure, economic structure, the conceptual structure, in a way we have not included this idea of business to solve problems. We have only one idea of business in the business world, to make money. So we created a money-centric world. As a result, money has become a habit for us. Money has become a kind of obsession for us. Sometimes it becomes an addiction for us. So as a result, we created all the problems that we see around us because of this obsession, because of this addiction to money. And that's where economists went wrong, because economists misinterpreted human beings. Economists assumed all human beings are single-dimensional beings. All they do in their lifetime is make money. Making money is their fun, making money is their life, making money is their goal of their life, which is wrong. That misinterpretation has created all the problems that we can see all over us. Human beings are much bigger than money-making robots. Economists made us into robots. So we want to go back to as a human being. As a human being who is selfish, as well as we are selfless beings. That selflessness is not included in the economic world. If you want to be selfless, economists tell you, you walk out of the business world, walk out of the economic world, you become a philanthropist. You give away your money and solve the problems you want to solve by giving away money. Giving away money is a wonderful thing to solve problems. That's the only thing we learned over years. But it has a limitation. The limitation is it cannot be repeated endlessly. Every time you want to repeat, you need the equal amount of money to do that. So the limit, money restricts you. It does only one job. Whatever money you have, you get the money to do the job. If money goes there, it never comes back. In order to do the same thing again, you have to have a fresh bunch of money to do that again. So if you are in charity, many of the charity organizations you are familiar with, they spend more time in raising money than doing the actual work. So that's a waste of time. I said, somehow, if you can transform that work into a social business to do the good work that you were solving problems, then that same money will go out and do the job and come back. And you can send it back again to the same thing all over again. So it does it in a repetitive way, in an endlessly repetitive way. And this is the kind of business, problem-solving business that I'm calling social business, is a non-dividend company to solve problems. And if you can create that non-dividend company to solve problems, you created a machine which works by itself. It doesn't have to be refueled from outside. It fuels itself. It's a self-fueling engine, never stops. It becomes very powerful. So this is the kind of businesses that we're talking about. And we created many of these companies. And we created a nursing college in the idea of social business in education. We take the girls from the poor families, those who have finished their high school and qualified to enter a nursing college, because now there are plenty of those young girls in Grameen families. We bring them into the nursing college, give them the education loan, and the nursing college itself recovers all its cost. And the nurses get a good education. It's a joint venture with Glasgow Caledonian University. And they have good jobs in Bangladesh, and they have good jobs internationally, because Bangladesh has enormous demand for nurses, because we have a very strange situation in Bangladesh. We have 3 doctors per nurse. So you can imagine what is the shortage is like. It should have been the other way, 3 nurses per doctor. So we have to fill that gap, and there is not enough nurses being produced. So why not? If you trained a girl to be a nurse, she has jobs not only in Bangladesh, she can do a job of a nurse anywhere in the world, get very good salary, and have helped the family to do that. But we don't do that. So we said, why don't you do it as a social business? Business which will cover the cost. At the same time, it's not intended to make profit for anybody. It's focused on doing the job. We created eye care hospital. Cataract is a big problem in Bangladesh. There's not enough capacity to do the cataract operation. So we did the first cataract hospital with a capacity of 10,000 cataract operation per year. and we designed it as a social business. It covers its cost. We charge the regular market price for the people who can afford, and we make money, and we cross-subsidize the poor people who pay very tiny little money for $1 or $2 to do the same thing. And the whole hospital covers its own cost. And the first one got into break-even point in 3.5 years. So we set up the next eye care hospital, which did it in 3 years, break-even point. Now we are moving into third and the fourth eye care hospital. So once you are in a social business mode, expansion becomes very easy because you are recovering your cost, recovering your money. In social business, you get your money back, but you never get any dividend out of it. So you can go on a series of these companies. And I was very pleasantly surprised when big companies wanted to do social business with us. So the first one was at Danone. We have a joint venture with Danone to address the problem of malnutrition among the poor children. We produce yogurt and make it very cheap so that even the poor child can afford it. If a child eats this yogurt regularly within 8 to 9 months, the child recovers all the deficiency in micronutrients and becomes a healthy child. If a child is malnourished, not only the child physically gets stunted, it's also become mentally stunted. And nearly half the children of Bangladesh are malnourished. It's not a good news for a nation to have half the children malnourished and become physically stunted, and worse of it, mentally stunted. You're not as smart as you could have been because you didn't have the micronutrients which you needed. So we want to address that as a social business. We are not against what the government will do, what others will do, what the NGOs will do. We're saying that we are not opposed to anybody. We're saying that if there's a space, we'll go and do it. We'll not sit around and watch it happen. So we create businesses after businesses. We have created water company to bring water in the villages in an affordable way so that you can run it as a social business. Water is a big problem in Bangladesh. Water is a big problem in many, many countries around the world. Our groundwater is arsenic contaminated. Our surface water is polluted. So you are trapped. You don't know what water to drink because both are bad. So we are now coming up with this social business, trying it out, how to place it. Each social business is a small business to begin with. You are creating a prototype. Once the prototype works, then you can repeat as many times as you want because each one is a self-contained, self-sufficient. It can go on and on and on. Social business is all about human creativity. If you put your mind into solving problems, suddenly all the creative power that you have, all the technology that you have in your command, you can direct it in solving problems. Today, all the technology, all the creative power that we have, and each day it is increasing, it's not directed to solve problems. What is it directed to? It is directed to make money. And as a result, we are making more money, but we are creating more problems. So if we can now open the door by creating a new structure of conceptual framework that there are two kinds of businesses, business to make money and business to solve problems. And we tell our students, tell our young people, this is how the world moves. They will decide, each one will decide what they will do as they grow up, whether they should be working for a social business, they should be working for a profit-making business, or they should be creating a social business, or they should be creating a for-profit company for themselves to make money, get rich. So it's their choice. So social business is about a choice. It expands the choice basket for people. Nobody's forcing you to do this or that. And once that economist has to understand, not only making money is a happiness, that's what you're pursuing in the world, to make yourself happy by making more money. Making other people happy is also happiness. Economists never admitted that, never accepted that, or never become aware of that. So include that. Making other people happy is also a happiness. So you have a choice of happiness, or a combination of happiness. You can make yourself happy from both ways. Making money by having a profit-making business, at the same time having social business to make other people happy, solve the problem, be remembered by the people that, yes, you have found a way to solve the problem. And that's a challenge for all of us. I'm very happy when I'm coming here for the Bocelli Foundation. We'll be talking about social business in Bocelli Foundation. Also tomorrow, there will be the city of Pistoia, they will be starting, they will be declaring the city itself as the social business city of Pistoia. So there will be a social business city, meaning that every business in Pistoia will have a parallel social business along with it. So that problems in Pistoia can be solved by their own people, by their business way, so that the city doesn't have to carry the burden of solving everybody's problem. Citizens can solve the problem in a big way and become an example. When you create a solution in your own city, that becomes an example for the whole world, because your city has the same problem every other city, every other community has. If you can find a solution to your problem in a social business way, that will be replicated, they'll be emulated in anywhere in the world. Ultimately, we can create a world that we want to have. There is no reason why there should be poverty, because poverty doesn't belong to people. So we change the system, poverty disappears. When poverty disappears, we create poverty museum, so that in future generation, when they would like to know what the poverty used to be like, they wouldn't see it in this planet. They have to go to those museums to see, like you have the museum right here, to see what is Pisa used to be. So similarly, they will go to the poverty museum. Why should anybody be unemployed? Did you ask that question? Who is responsible for unemployment? Is the person responsible? Is the young man, young woman, who is prepared himself or herself to start her life and made all the things, he is energetic, creative, and ready to go, but she is wasted away, he is wasted away. Is it his fault? Is it her fault? No. Whose fault is this? Ask yourself that question. If the system is responsible for this, why can't you throw that system in the trash can and create a system which can allow each human being to fulfill their life and make yourself happy, contributing the energy and creativity that you have? Unless we come to that conclusion, we are not going to go very far. So we have to put our mind into it to design that system where nobody will be an unemployed person, nobody will be on welfare, nobody will be a poor person, nobody will have unnecessary debt, and the planet will be a safer planet. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Congratulations. I need to know all these things. I'm learning now.
Thank you, Professor Yunus, for these inspiring and thought-provoking words. And I think it's very nice what you said about the mother and the daughter, and you know, how you should let the next generation free to express themselves in the way that you know, that is most congenial, because the next speaker will actually be the next generation. And I think she'll give a message that is about how important, once you do something good, is to let this be known around the world, let this be communicated, and if it's communicated with a beautiful voice, then the message spreads much more quickly. So let me give the word to Monica Yunus, co-founder and director of Sing for Hope.
Buonasera a tutti. Non sono un banchiere. Sono cantante e stasera sono molto molto fortunato, un cantante molto fortunato, perché ho cantato stamattina con Maestro Bocelli e fra qualche giorno anche canterò ancora, e sono molto molto felice e vorrei ringraziarvi per questa opportunità e anche a Maestro Bocelli e la fondazione di Andrea Bocelli. I will speak now in English because that's easier for me, and I'm very, very happy to have this opportunity to tell you just a little tiny bit about my organization, Sing for Hope. Sing for Hope is, what is Sing for Hope? Sing for Hope is an artist peace corps. What does that mean? What do? We mobilize over 1,000 professional artists of all kinds, from singers, yes, opera singers, to painters, to dancers, in volunteer service programs that bring the power of the arts to those who need it most.
We began Sing for Hope, the Sing for Hope journey, about 6 years ago while students at Juilliard. My colleague and I, and fellow soprano Camille Zamora, and I had a shared vision which grew out of tragedy. Camille lost her school friend to HIV/AIDS. In his honor, she started a small concert in Houston, Texas to raise funds for the AIDS hospice where he passed away. That concert has since raised over $4 million for the Bering Omega AIDS Hospice. And when Camille and I met at Juilliard, there were many things going on in the world. Among them, Hurricane Katrina, which devastated New Orleans in the U.S., was a call to action for me. Having been born in Bangladesh, where floods are rampant, in fact, just last week in Chittagong, where I was born, there was a major flood, and over 110 people died. I felt compelled to do something, but what could I do? I was just a student at Juilliard, a singer. I spent most of my time in the practice room for hours trying to perfect this thing called the voice, and I didn't know what to do. I felt very helpless. So I turned to Camille to help me organize an event to raise some money for the victims of Katrina. On the morning after the concert, we decided that Sing for Hope was not one concert because of a tragedy. It was a way for artists to give back, a continuation of something we call arts activism in action. Sing for Hope would then exist to mobilize artists in volunteer service. Today, Sing for Hope has three programs. Healing Arts, which brings live performances to patients and caregivers in healthcare facilities. ArtU, as in Art University. This program engages under-resourced youth through dynamic arts classes and interactive performances. Community Arts, which makes art accessible to all, enlivening and uniting communities through the arts and through arts outreach programs. Our largest and most branded community arts project is Sing for Hope's Pop-Up Pianos. For 2 weeks last summer and the summer before, we put 88 pianos in the parks and public spaces of New York, in all five boroughs, so not just Manhattan, in the Bronx, in Queens, in every single borough, there were pianos for anyone and everyone to play. There were hundreds of artists. Each piano was done by a different artist, so the piano became the canvas for these artists. There were pop-up concerts by these professional artists. There were amateurs who were taking part on the streets of New York. The pop-up pianos enlivened our city streets. They were then donated after those 2 weeks to communities in need. So the schools and the hospitals which we work with, these pianos were donated then to them to make sure that the music plays on. Sing for Hope's Pop-Up Pianos are a celebration of our vision, of the Sing for Hope vision, which is art for all. Now bear with me one moment while I just do a little technical thing. I'd love to give you a little bit of a taste of the project. This is a very short video that I'd like to show you. Let's see if it works. Warehouse. We had a warehouse in Tribeca where all of them were brought together for the artists to
when you walk through the warehouse,
work
it's
on the piano.
To see how these pieces evolve and for the artists to be around each other as their individual pieces are evolving is great. There's just such a scope of different artists, and each one of them came up with a really different idea. So the
I decided to do something that that took the interactive element to another level. So I painted the entire piano with chalkboard paint and allowed people to come play, draw, write, do whatever they want with the piano.
I want to make mine like really playful so you can look at it, you know, you laugh at it or feel really comfortable to go and play it.
That's one reason I chose to do a piano illustrated for children. I mean, that was my main goal, was to make the children feel like they were comfortable enough to come over and play and have fun with it too.
Well, you get the visual at least. I hope you're hearing the sound. But each one of the pianos was done over the course of the 2 weeks. Each one had a piano buddy.
So if it rained, there was the opportunity for the piano to be covered and taken care of.
And opened up the piano. I talked with some people who are around, you know, encouraged them to use the piano. And you know, sometimes the parents want to shout at the kids and say, get away from there. I said, no, it's for them too. It's for the community.
A lot of our young people have never really seen a real piano up front and center. So it's amazing and it's fun to sit down with them and really play and see that energy and excitement.
People are really excited about it and they really want to, you know, because you can touch it, it's physical. Like, they get to be a part of it, so they feel some sort of ownership to it, even if they're just walking by to play it. It's like, I played that, I touched that, I interacted with that.
They're interacting with the art itself, but they're also interacting with each other.
I don't think you would see these two guys talking to these ladies in strollers, like, otherwise, unless, like, one of them was playing an upright piano that was, for some reason, in the middle of a public park. You know, it's an opportunity to kind of, I don't know, take the New York mask off, I guess, you know, and just sort of let your guard down, even just for a minute, and communicate with someone that you might not otherwise have a vehicle to communicate with.
What Synchrohope does is to make art radically available to the people who need it most.
You say, oh, you put a piano in the South Bronx and people are going to destroy it, and that's not the case. You know, like, I love the fact that this piano has challenged that stereotype. You know, we in the South Bronx are worthy of this piano, you know, and at the end of the day, this piano will continue to live and be a part of this community, and I think that is exactly what Synchrohope is trying to accomplish, that we have access, we can appreciate it, and we can take care of it.
This pop-up piano moment is actually part of a continuum. It's about year-round transformation of these communities.
At the end of those 2 weeks, all of the pianos are donated to schools and hospitals that we work with, so there's a continuation of making music and making sure that that is shared with communities in need, places that don't have access to music. And we also bring artists to those places.
But I could still learn it if I put my mind to it.
It's a definite uplift, especially for seniors and the children, you know. It's most important because music, you know, it keeps the soul up high, you know, makes you feel good. Even if you can't sing, you know, play the piano or whatever musical instrument, it's good. It's good for you to be able to have it, that outlet.
Sweet melody, sweet songs in harmony.
When I listen to music, it brings a different attitude to my body, to my soul. You know what I mean? And it's a blessing for us to have this. I love these guys here, and this is a part of love. This musical instrument is a part of love from other people like you and other people who donated it. They donate stuff with love to it so that people like us can appreciate it because it's music and it helps you grow up.
For Hope's promise to our city that we will bring these instruments to these communities and we will galvanize professional artists in volunteerism to do this for our
that
city.
That piano was played by Mayor Bloomberg.
It creates change on a grassroots level, and I think that is our commitment, is to make this an annual festival, an open festival of art for everyone. ¶¶
you can get a sense for that each one of these was done by a different artist at Times Square and had a different theme. So I just wanted to thank you again for allowing me the opportunity to tell you a little bit about Sing for Hope. Again, so honored to be here and to have the opportunity to speak to the Andrea Bocelli Foundation and to have the honor of singing with Maestro Bocelli this coming on the 12th in his hometown. Thank you so much.
Ci arriviamo alla conclusione di questo pomeriggio straordinario e io dentro di me tiravo anch'io le mie conclusioni, no? E stavo pensando che stasera esco da questo incontro in un certo senso estremamente malconcio, perché sono entrato in questa stanza convinto di essere un maestro di ottimismo e invece mi sono accorto che qui al mio fianco siede qualcuno che è molto, molto più ottimista di me. E che è riuscito nei fatti, che è riuscito a tradurre in fatti il suo ottimismo. Dentro di me pensavo, se io mi metto a prestare dei soldi a destra e a sinistra, prima di tutto non me ne torna neanche uno dei soldi, perché ognuno deve veramente fare quello che sa fare. Però per fortuna nel mondo c'è la gente che sa fare, ed è a questa gente che noi bisogna dar fiducia, sono queste le persone che noi dobbiamo ascoltare e seguire, con umiltà, perché il professor Yunus è nato per fare queste cose. L'unica cosa che non è ancora riuscito a fare, e non so se sarà tanto facile, è quello di creare un'impresa di professor Yunus. Cioè, in modo di crearne 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 a questo mondo. E questo sarà molto difficile. Però sicuramente, seguendo la sua strada, ci saranno domani tante persone in grado di fare, se non quello che ha fatto lui, ma sicuramente grandi cose. Noi abbiamo provato così a vivere un sogno, un'idea, creando questa fondazione. Alcuni anni fa, perché nulla avviene a caso a questo mondo, una ragazzina, allora diciottenne, venne a casa mia e mi disse, timidamente mi disse, io sono venuta per chiederle una cosa, se lei potesse fare un concerto per gli ammalati di AIDS. Un concerto di beneficenza, così, nella mia città. E io gli dissi, sì, facciamo. E i problemi che lei incontrò da quel momento lì in poi furono che nessuno ci credeva che io sarei andato a fare il concerto là da lei, no? Lei ha tenuto duro e abbiamo fatto questo concerto. Addirittura non c'era nessuno che mi venisse a prendere perché non credevano che fosse arrivato. E abbiamo fatto il concerto, abbiamo raccolto una cifra che spero sia andata a buon fine. La ragazza di allora è cresciuta, si è laureata in legge e guarda un po' il caso, si è anche specializzata in problematiche che riguardano le fondazioni. Allora quando io ho pensato di creare la ABF, l'Andrea Bocelli Foundation, vuoi che non mi sia venuto in mente di richiamarla? Ha detto, ti ricordi il concerto per l'AIDS, eccetera, eccetera. Adesso sai cosa c'è? Che mi è venuto in mente che potresti essere la presidente della nostra fondazione. Devo dire che lei ci ha pensato un po' di più, non ha detto subito di sì. Però ha accettato l'incarico, che per lei è un impegno enorme, lo capisco e la ringrazio. Ed è a lei che cedo la parola per concludere questo giorno, che per molti di noi è veramente un giorno importante e bello, perché abbiamo sentito parlare di cose reali, realistiche, realizzabili e anche realizzate. Quindi do la parola al Presidente della Fondazione, Laura Biancalani, e vi ringrazio infinitamente di essere stati qui.
Che dire, grazie Andrea, autorità, relatori, gentili ospiti. È arrivato il momento di chiudere la nostra 2 giorni di riflessioni, di scambi e di legami. E come Presidente desidero entrare in punta di piedi per dire poche cose, per ringraziarvi tutti. La prima vittoria dell'Andrea Bocelli Foundation è stata gettare le basi per la costruzione di una rete di energia, di istituzioni, ma soprattutto di persone. Persone che hanno voglia di mettersi in gioco per costruire. Perché questo è il momento di spendersi per costruire. Sono quasi 20 anni che conosco Andrea e le cose che più mi ha insegnato sono non aver paura, affrontare tutto con tenacia, lavorare insieme per costruire e avere fiducia nel prossimo. E sono poi le 4 C con cui intendiamo lavorare con ABF, il coraggio di credere nei piccoli e grandi cambiamenti che possiamo attuare e dare inizio a qualcosa di vero, il coraggio di avere e dare fiducia. La cura o il prendersi cura delle persone che ci sono attorno, accorgersi del loro disagio e della loro forza inespressa. La creatività, saper giocare con le cose, sapere che si possono scoprire cose sorprendenti confrontandosi, lavorando insieme, aprendosi alle realtà e agli altri nel vivere quotidiano. La cooperazione, attivare relazioni positive fra donatore e fondazione, fra fondazione e beneficiario, far convergere volontà e bisogni attraverso attività di intermediazione filantropica affinché chiunque, grande o piccolo, possa partecipare e dare il proprio contributo con risorse umane, materiali ed economiche. A queste intendiamo unire l'ultima C, che è la competenza, perché le azioni siano efficaci al massimo. Come avete compreso, anche nella giornata di oggi, ABF agirà nei 2 programmi, Challenges e Break the Barriers, dando grande importanza alla ricerca, anche nell'agire per combattere la povertà. Integrare la ricerca con l'azione, sia nel momento dell'analisi dei bisogni che della valutazione dell'impatto dell'azione, è ciò che potrebbe rendere lo sforzo di tutti più efficace per cambiare e migliorare anche di un poco il mondo in cui stiamo vivendo. Noi ci crediamo e speriamo che questo laboratorio vivo che abbiamo visto crescere in questi 2 giorni possa crescere ancora e diventare uno strumento per costruire e aprire di più e sempre la nostra Toscana al mondo. Chiudo cercando di ringraziare da parte del Consiglio di Amministrazione, nelle persone di Veronica e Alberto, tutti quelli che ci hanno permesso di realizzare queste 2 prime giornate in città. Le istituzioni. Ringrazio però particolarmente i rettori dell'Università di Pisa, di Firenze e della Scuola Superiore Sant'Anna. E una nota all'unica donna fra questi rettori, che devo dire mi ha sostenuto molto. Ringrazio l'opera della primaziale nella persona del suo presidente Pier Francesco Pacini, le segreterie e gli uffici stampa delle università che ci hanno aiutato a diffondere i nostri programmi. Ringrazio i membri del nostro advisory, che sono quasi tutti, tranne Mohamed Abdul Latif Jamil, che comunque non ci ha mai fatto mancare il suo sostegno. Infatti, Abhijit del suo Jaipal è qui. I membri del nostro attivissimo collegio dei revisori. Ringrazio i nostri partner, Acquespa, che ringrazio particolarmente per aver contribuito a riportare in Italia il professor Yunus. A WMAP, la Fondazione Unitalsi, Massimo Rebecchi e Pacini Editore. Ringraziamo di cuore CR Salute nella persona di Concetta, che è stata instancabile segreteria dei workshop. Ringraziamo di cuore anche le nostre collaboratrici Olimpia e Roberta e tutti i volontari venuti anche da lontano e tutti coloro che gratuitamente hanno prestato tempo e risorse per costruire una casa comune. In ultimo, ma non ultimi, tutte le signore della Fondazione Rava, Padre Rick e il professor Mosca e la Fondazione ARPA. Dear friends here and online, thanks a lot for your attention. I would like to invite all to help us to build together a common house where Andrea and his voice can be really useful for everyone. Thanks and follow us, please. Adesso ci trasferiamo tutti nel chiostro bellissimo dell'opera primaziale per un momento musicale. Grazie a tutti.